Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to present on the results of the current global scenario studies of different institutions, including the World Energy Council's World Energy Scenarios to 2060, launched at the World Energy Congress in September 2019. Since autumn 2020, various projections have been published. The World Energy Outlook 2020 by the International Energy Agency and Energy Perspectives by Equinor, BP, Bloomberg, DNV, and most recently by McKinsey and IRENA. They all include the effects of the corona pandemic. The time horizon is 2040, respectively 2050. I analyzed these studies and I would like to present the main messages that these papers reveal. I would like to cover the following topics: the development in the global energy and power mix 1985 to 2019, followed by a categorization of global energy scenarios, the main messages of exploratory scenarios, the results of different projections in comparison, a synopsis of normative scenarios, increased electrification and expanded use of hydrogen as key enablers to achieving the climate goals, and finally, I would like to draw some conclusions. Before presenting the main findings of the different scenario reports which cover the upcoming 20 to 40 years, I would like to say a few words about the past. Global primary energy consumption has doubled since 1985. Main drivers were population growth of approximately 60% and rise in the global GDP of 160%. This increase in energy demand was mainly covered by fossil fuels. The result is the share of fossil fuels in the total primary energy consumption was only 4 percentage points less in 2019 compared to 1985. 84% of the total primary energy consumption are still covered by coal, oil, and gas. The share of nuclear energy increased from 5% in 1985 to 6% in 2000 and then decreased to 4% in 2019. Renewable energies accounted for 12% in 2019 compared to 7% in 1985. And the global CO2 emissions, due to the strong increase in fossil fuels, CO2 emissions were 77% higher in 2019 compared to 1985. The global power demand even increased by 173% compared to 1985. Also in the case of electricity, the major part of the increase was covered by fossil fuels, coal and gas. The share of renewables was 26% in 2019 compared to 21% in 1985. The share of nuclear was 10% in 2019 compared to 15% in 1985. That means the share of coal, gas, and oil remained unchanged, 64% in 2019 compared to 64%, exactly the same number in 1985. I started my presentation with a look back at the time from 1985 to today. It became clear that energy consumption and even more power generation have increased significantly, but the energy mix has largely remained unchanged. No transition, but only additions. The upcoming decades will be different. several institutions have published reports on the possible global energy future. The methods vary and the results mainly depend on the respective approach and the underlying assumptions. One can distinguish, in principle, distinguish between exploratory scenarios, outlooks, and normative scenarios. The characteristics of these different approaches, the three different approaches I mentioned, are shown in this slide. I analyzed the reports on the global energy perspectives that has been published by several institutions over the past few months, including the World Energy Council scenario study, which was presented in September 2019. In these reports, projections and scenarios with different approaches are presented. I have assigned the different approaches to three categories. The first category can be characterized as plausible pathways of alternative future contexts that can occur regardless of whether we want this or not. These are qualitative-based, narrative-led storylines which are illustrated by numbers as an outcome of modeling. With the second category, which is called outlooks, respectively projections, the characteristics vary. In forecasts, for example, an attempt is made to present future developments on the basis of parameters that are assumed to be likely. This approach is different from projections showing what is likely to happen if, for example, the existing legal framework remains unchanged in the future, or if, as an alternative to this approach, all measures that have been announced by the governments are implemented in the future. And the third category can be called normative scenarios. In normative scenarios, a technically possible preferable future is created. The scenarios start from a clear objective by backcasting to identify the pathway for achieving the target. Let me start with the first category. The Norwegian company Equinor, McKinsey, and the World Energy Council have presented different scenarios, which can be assigned to the category exploratory scenarios. In this slide, the results for the primary energy consumption in 2050 are presented, which are indicated in the Equinor and in the World Energy Council's scenario. And the main messages are only a slight increase in the global primary energy consumption is to be expected, different from the past. The additional consumption is also different from the past, mainly covered by renewable energies. Fossil fuels are still going to cover the major part of the primary energy consumption in 2050, between 58 and 74%, depending on the respective scenario. The role of nuclear energy increases slightly, but the share will remain limited also in 2050. Let me now go a little bit more into detail as far as the World Energy Council's scenarios are concerned. The World Energy Council has published three scenarios: modern jazz, unfinished symphony, and hard rock. The scenario names reflect various music genres, given an idea of the mood of each scenario. Modern jazz, one can quote that jazz is the music of boundless individualism, where improvisation and innovation are essential elements. Modern jazz follows a market-driven approach accordingly. And for unfinished symphony, you cannot play a symphony alone. It takes an orchestra to play it and a conductor to take the lead. Unfinished symphony follows a government-driven approach accordingly. And finally, hard rock. In this scenario, it is assumed that national interests prevent countries from collaborating effectively on a global level with limited attention to addressing climate change. The scenarios selected are exploratory routes through the grand transition. They don't follow a normative approach, and they should not be seen as forecasts or projections. Rather, they span a range of plausible pathways of the future. A comparison between the developments in the past and the scenario results for the future shows new technologies will keep energy demand growth moderate relative to historical trends. Per capita energy demand will peak before 2030. The share of fossil fuels, which remained more or less stable in the past, declines in all scenarios, most notably in Unfinished Symphony. Nuclear energy is going to increase its share slightly, in particular in the scenario Unfinished Symphony, because of the assumption of high CO2 prices and strong governmental support in favor of low carbon technologies. The strongest increase is indicated for renewable energies, also in particular in Unfinished Symphony, for the same reason mentioned for nuclear energy. That means governmental support and high CO2 prices. This slide impressively demonstrates the grand transition that is expected in the power sector. In 2015, the share of renewable energies in the total global power generation was 23%, exactly the same number as in 1970. This means that there has been no increase in the share of renewables within these 45 years. But that is going to change within the upcoming 45 years. In all World Energy Council scenarios, we see a strong increase in the share of renewable energies. And these results might even underestimate the future development of renewable energies. The share might be higher than shown in this slide. None of the scenarios shows a development which will lead to the Paris Agreement being reached. In Unfinished Symphony, CO2 emissions peaked in 2019. In Modern Jazz, this will take place by 2030, and in Hard Rock by 2040. This causes the global temperature to rise by 2 to 2.3 degrees Celsius in Unfinished Symphony, 2.5 degrees Celsius in Modern Jazz, and more than 3 degrees in Hard Rock. Next slide indicates the results of the projections published in the fourth quarter of 2020 by the International Energy Agency, DNV, BP, Bloomberg, followed by McKinsey in January 2021. And the main messages are: peak coal consumption globally was in 2014. Peak oil consumption might occur within the 2020s, and peak gas consumption is expected for the 2030s. The contribution of nuclear energy will be more or less stable between 4 and 6% in 2050 compared to 5% in 2019. the share of renewable energies in the total primary energy consumption will be approximately twice as high in 2050 compared to 2019. Let me go a little more detail about one of the projections. This is the International Energy Agency's stated policy scenario. In this scenario, one of the three scenarios which the Energy Agency published in November last year, in this scenario, the International Energy Agency assumes that not only the currently valid regulatory and legal requirements remain in place, but that measures announced by the governments will also be implemented, even if these measures are not fixed by law. This slide shows what can be expected for fossil fuels and renewable energies by 2040, that means in the next 20 years compared to the past 20 years, under the conditions described. The consumption of coal will decrease in the future, while in the past there was still a strong increase, mainly due to the development in China. The consumption of oil will increase in the future, but much less than in the past. And the consumption of gas is increasing almost at the same rate as in the last 20 years. Renewable energies are growing more than twice as fast as in the last 2 decades. So really differences between the various energy carriers. This slide shows the growth in global primary energy consumption from 2019 to 2040, differentiated by world regions. The foreseeable shift in the focus of consumption towards Asia is becoming clear. There are also increases in the Middle East, Africa, and South America. In contrast, a decline in primary energy consumption is to be expected for North America, for Europe, and for Japan by 2040. Particularly strong differences between the various regions of the world can be seen with regard to the development of coal consumption. In Europe and the US, coal consumption will decrease by almost 3/4 by 2040 compared to 2019 levels. In Africa and in the Eurasia region, coal consumption remains roughly constant. In China, coal consumption will decline compared to 2019, but even with the expected decrease in consumption to the level of 2010, China will still account for more than half of global coal consumption in 2040. Increases in coal consumption in the upcoming decades are only expected in India and a few Asian countries. In India, coal consumption will almost double by 2040 compared to 2019. That means the strongest increase in coal consumption is expected for India. This slide shows impressively how global investments in power generation systems are distributed by technology. First of all, a global expansion in power generation capacity of more than 8,500 gigawatt is expected by 2040. And that is 38 times as much as is currently installed in Germany in total electricity generation capacity. Almost a third of this can be seen as a replacement of existing plants. but 2/3 of the new installations serve to meet the growing demand for electricity globally. Particularly noteworthy is the expected distribution of the newly installed generation capacities by energy source. Each symbol in this slide represents a capacity of around 225 gigawatt, and the 225 gigawatt corresponds to the capacity installed in Germany. Just to provide a dimension of what is going to happen. Renewable energies account for more than 3/4 of the expansion, around 15% only for gas, and the rest for coal, nuclear energy, and oil. Let me come back to the climate issue. This slide demonstrates that even the accelerated transition pathway of the McKinsey study lags far behind the 1.5 degrees Celsius pathway. In the accelerated transition scenario, emissions by 2050 are 20% lower than in the reference case of McKinsey. However, greenhouse gas emissions by 2050 need to drop by 90% compared to the current level. And this is where the normative scenarios come in, which show what has to happen in order for the climate goals to be achieved. This slide indicates the results of normative scenarios presented by the International Energy Agency, by BP, by Equinor, and by Bloomberg. The main messages are there is a strong transformation from the fossil energy world to a future supply dominated by renewable energies. Coal will be nearly phased out, completely phased out by 2050. The share of oil will be strongly reduced. Only the losses for gas are expected to be still limited. The share of renewables in the global primary energy consumption will more than double by 2040 and more than triple by 2050. Nuclear energy can increase its share from 5% today up to 10% in 2050 in these normative scenarios. IRENA and this International Renewable Energy Association in Abu Dhabi presented also a forecast in March. They expect that the global energy consumption of fossil energies is going to decrease by 77% in the period from 2019 to 2050. That means only 25% less than 25% of the current consumption of fossil fuels, oil, gas, and coal, will remain in 2050. The consumption of coal, oil, and natural gas would decrease accordingly from approximately 12 million tons of oil equivalent to less than 3 million tons of oil equivalent by the middle of the century. This even goes a little bit further than according to McKinsey's model calculations. The greatest change is expected for electricity. The main messages are the future world will be more electric than the past. Global electricity consumption would be more than twice as high in 2050 and even 3 times as high as in 2019, according to IRENA. And more than 80% of the global power generation could be based on renewable energies by 2050. IRENA even shows a share of 90% for renewable energies for the year 2050. The remaining 10% of electricity generation would be based roughly equally on natural gas and nuclear energy. Coal would be completely phased out for power generation in 2050, according to the results of IRENA in this normative scenario. The share of nuclear energy remains more or less stable, at least in the IEA scenarios. The dominance of fossil fuels belongs to the past. Above all, the share of coal, today number one energy source for power generation, is falling sharply, in the case of IRENA, as I indicated, to zero. In addition to strong growth in electricity consumption, hydrogen is gathering strong momentum as a key energy transition pillar. McKinsey identified 228 hydrogen projects globally, strongly concentrated on Europe, but covering the other world regions as well. If all projects are to be realized, including the announced projects, $300 billion investment in hydrogen could take place through 2030. Of this $300 billion, more than $80 billion is already covered by projects that have been implemented and planned. The 228 announced projects globally cover the whole value chain, from production, infrastructure, transport, and usage. It is expected that the major part of hydrogen will be green hydrogen produced by electrolysis using renewable energies. Electricity from nuclear power plants also offers the possibility of CO2-free generation of hydrogen. And coal and gas could also be used as a basis for CO2-free production of hydrogen, provided that the CO2 is captured and used or stored. To realize the energy transition, which is indispensable for achieving the ambitious climate goals, strong policies are necessary that stimulate innovation and are focused on the following fields. Increasing use of renewable energies is essential. Nevertheless, coal as well as gas will still be used in the coming decades, not so much in the power sector, but in the heating sector and in transport. Therefore, the widespread implementation of carbon capture and storage or usage of CO2 is indispensable for achieving climate goals. Because also in industry, we see CO2 emissions, which can be only covered and captured by carbon capture and storage. So this technology is indispensable in addition to the expected increase in renewable energies. Oil can be replaced by hydrogen and synthetic fuels in the long run, in particular in the transport sector and in industry. Nuclear energy can play an important role as an additional enabler of carbon neutral electricity in some parts of the world. Increased electrification in the building and transport sectors is an important issue. Improving energy efficiency remains a powerful lever in all consumption sectors. And the general conclusion, CO2 pricing as global as possible. Technology neutral support mechanisms by governments and greater international cooperation are crucial. crucial to achieving the sustainability goals. Thank you very much for your attention.